Oh, we are. Okay. We're waiting for one more person. Waiting on two more people. So before we actually start, I wanted to recite the gatha that Tai wrote for reciting the Diamond Sutra. We're not reciting the sutra, no worries. But just to kind of, give us a little bit of a sense. So the opening gatha for the Diamond that Cut Through Illusion Sutra. How may we overcome the fear of birth and death and arrive at the state that is indestructible as a diamond? What way can direct us in our practice to sweep away our thousands of illusions? If the awakened mind shows its compassion and opens up for us the treasure store, then we may bring into our lives the wonderful diamond teachings. So as we go through that, that's kind of like what we're trying to to understand, how to overcome the fear of birth and death and arrive at a state that is as indestructible as a diamond. So, and there is an answer already, there's already an answer in the gatha about how to do it. It says, if the awakened mind shows us its compassion, that's kind of like it's already telling us what the key here is, and it's rather interesting because the Diamond Sutra is a Prajnaparamita Sutra, meaning it's about supreme understanding, supreme wisdom, and it supposedly is not about compassion, and yet it is, and it's actually the same thing you can say about the Heart Sutra. The Heart Sutra is supposed to be the great sutra of wisdom, and it's not given by Manjushri, who's the bodhisattva of great understanding. It's given by Avalokiteshvara, the bodhisattva of great compassion. So compassion and wisdom must come together. They create something together. So to look at that. And then to the originally, when we came up with this retreat, I was thinking, oh, you know, people always like the Prajnaparamitas, and you know, they're always interested in the Heart Sutra, the Diamond Sutra. You know, it's like we have this great thing called emptiness, and you know, we love emptiness, right? And you know, whenever there's a problem, whenever there's an issue, we say, oh, emptiness. Emptiness is the solution. So you know, so we need to keep investigating emptiness, right? And then we thought, well, let's do a 5 mindfulness training or transmission tomorrow morning. So then it became, how do we bring the two together? So, you know, the title became something I think like the ultimate meets the practical. You know, sort of how do we take something like the Diamond Sutra, which some of you may have read or not, I don't know. But can sound quite, whoa, like, excuse me, you know, it's quite high language, you know, and how do we make it practical, very concrete in our lives? So that's really something to, you know, that's my interest, you know, in trying to bring that together. You know, when the Buddha was enlightened, and they say, you know, there's this description how he went through the 3 watches of the night, whatever the 3 watches of the night are. I don't know what they mean in Indian understanding. You know, there's certain hours that mean something. I guess they're a little closer to the equator, so there's no difference between summer watches and winter watches. I'm not sure, but they say on the first watch he observed all his everything that happened to him throughout generations and understood it. Whether you interpret that as reincarnations or not, it really doesn't matter. And in the second watch, he understood all the other people, you know, all of humanity, the multitudes of people, and saw their past lives, etc. And in the third watch, this is where he really got it. And he understood that it all interconnects, that it's all one, and that there's, it all comes from one central place. And that's when he said, wow, I am the Buddha. And when Mara challenged him, he said, as my earth is the witness, and I really am enlightened. So you sort of, it's kind of interesting. Then he goes off and gives the first Dharma talk. And of course, some traditions say that the first Dharma talk the Buddha gave was the Avatamsaka Sutra, which is, you know, if you try and read it, you kind of, I get lost. I have no clue. It's like it's very difficult because there's one translation in English and it's very, very difficult to understand. And some people, there is a claim that the Avatamsaka Sutra, the Flower Adornment Sutra, is the first sutra that the Buddha ever said after enlightenment. And then he saw that people didn't understand, so he went back and said, okay, I'll give you the kid stuff. Maybe, I don't know. I wasn't there. I think that if we look at the language of those sutras, Avatamsaka Sutra, I think it's fairly clear that it was written a lot after the Buddha. That's just the impression that I understand. So my question is, so the thing to look at is the Buddha, after this like mind explosive, you know, LSD-like trip, that he's like getting full enlightenment and he is the Buddha and he gets it all. He gets all causes. He can see through all causes and conditions. He doesn't, like us, we say, oh, everything comes from causes and conditions. That's a big deal for us to be able to say, okay, this is not what it's causes and conditions creating it. That's huge for us to just get to that. Here is a guy who's like, he doesn't say that. He sees the cause. He sees throughout space and time. And what does he do? He goes off and talks about the 4 noble truths. There is suffering. There's causes of suffering. There's a way out of suffering. And here's a way. Let me be your physician. Let me help you and give you a way. So you've got to wonder, like, whoa. You know, we talk about Prajnaparamita. We talk about, you know, like transcendent wisdom. This guy's got it. You know, he's not playing games here. You know, he's totally got it. And yet he's choosing to talk about suffering. You know, there is something that's got to relate between there is suffering and the wisdom of empty, the wisdom of the Heart Sutra, the wisdom of the Diamond Sutra. We need to look at those sutras in those eyes, because I think the danger is that if we don't, it becomes a little bit intellectual. Everybody, we can all say, form is emptiness, emptiness is form, and it sounds pretty empty. It doesn't cut it. So we need to deepen our way of like looking at these sutras and making them, how does it relate to suffering? And Thay is always asking us to do that. It's not a new invention. It certainly isn't mine. So as we go through and we might look at what the Diamond Sutra says, or maybe we won't, I don't know, we'll see what happens. But it's easy to get carried and to sort of like say to ourselves, okay, can we come back? How does it apply to my suffering? What's going on here? So I think that's really worthwhile. And also, like I said in the guided meditations, that there is, I can't remember, it's maybe 20 or something. There's a place where Thay translates it as, there is no Dharma, Subuddhi, giving a Dharma talk in fact means that no talk is given. This is truly a Dharma talk. Okay, so it tells us a lot about, those of us who are a little bit like retreat junkies, and we love the Dharma talks, and, then we talk about that this was a really cool Dharma talk, or, oh, I was really disappointed, he wasn't so good today, or whatever. It's like the Dharma talk is irrelevant in some ways. The Dharma talk is a space in which we open, hopefully opens us up to the practice. And that's why I wanted to do these guided meditations, because when we look at the Heart Sutra, there's a phrase in the Heart Sutra that everybody like sort of ignores, they just jump over. Okay. The Bodhisattva Avalokita, while moving in a course of perfect understanding, and the next phrase is the one I wanted to emphasize, shed life, Jiao, to illuminate, shed light on the five skandhas, and found them equally empty. And it's kind of interesting that the phrase that everybody remembers is, form is emptiness, emptiness is form. If you ever look at anything about the Heart Sutra or people talk about it, they will recite, form is emptiness, emptiness is form. Okay, I got it. But there is something amazing about this phrase that I don't think we appreciate. She looked at her own body, feelings, perceptions, mental formations, consciousness, which is just a way to classify different things. Basically, looked at my own body and mind and found them to be equally empty. This is the revelation. And it's both the revelation and it's the way to get there. Look at your own body, look at your own mind. Keep investigating until something will open for me. So I think that, I don't know, maybe this Dharma talk is really about, rebelling against current, ideologies or something. But just to look at that phrase often, and then to look at the end, where people I think are a little bit, also don't put on enough emphasis, is that the bodhisattvas of the past, present, and future, thanks to this perfect understanding, liberate themselves. They, because there is no attainment, they overcome fear. Because there is no, with no fear, that's when we arrive at liberation. So that's another kind of part. And I also, this is recorded, I should be careful, but I feel that musically, when Michael, who was at the time Fabienne, wrote the music, it was very nice. Because it was kind of like a waltz at that point. It became a waltz. Because there is no attainment, the bodhisattvas, grounded in perfect understanding, have no obstacles for the mind. It kind of became like this sort of like waltz thing, which is, this is where what we want. We want to have no obstacles for our minds and to liberate ourselves, arrive at full, right, and universal enlightenment. This is what we're asking for. And now we've turned it back to it's more monotony-ish now. So I think that musically we can also emphasize or de-emphasize things. I'm not in a position to suggest, you know, by the way, can we go to another version? But that's just my sense of it, is that there is something in the Heart Sutra that we could grab a little bit more. No attainment, you know, non-fear, looking at our own skandhas, you know, looking at ourselves to understand, to arrive at liberation. So just kind of as a sideline of what I want to talk about. So that's why we did the first meditation, which is the meditation on looking at our body, looking at the body. My body and mind keep changing, and they're composed of many things. So we need to keep being reminded of that, because it's easy. It's easy to know. It's not easy to know. And when we really need that knowledge, you know, when we're upset, for example, we don't know this. You know, it's like we're upset is all there is. Anger is all there is in me at that point. So, and I don't see that it changes, and it's actually composed of many different things. It may have something to do that I eat for breakfast. May have not very far less to do with the person that's upsetting me and the fact that I'm constipated or whatever it is that I'm at that point. So, it's to see that everything comes from causes and conditions, and to really keep exercising this. Like, no, it's not what I think it is. It's many causes and conditions. It's not just this thing. It's many things. That's a huge part of the practice, to be able to stop and say, no, it's not. So Thay has this mantra that he's offered us that says, are you sure? And I've used that mantra when I sent the, you know, like there was a little preparation guide if you wanted it. And I use that mantra, and I have to apologize. I'm realizing this is not the right mantra for me. This is the right mantra for Thay. We go to Thay, and we ask him to give us advice. So he says to us, are you sure? You asking me? You want me to help you? So I say, are you sure? Thay says that mantra. I can't say that mantra. The mantra is, am I sure? And I think I know it sounds like grammatical, kind of not so important, but look at how people use the mantra, and look at how they use it to tell other people how to think and whether it's correct thinking or not. And at that point you know, whoops, I got caught. Are you sure? Am I sure? And why am I asking you if you're sure? Where does this come from? So I told you, there's a little bit of rebelliousness in me today, so watch out. So I'm kind of thinking we should change the mantra and collectively try and do that, so that it really is about us. Am I sure? Am I sure of my perceptions? So another sideline, so to speak. And then the second guided meditation was really, you know, this is where the Diamond Sutra is, you know, sort of brings it up a little bit more strongly, is what are the appearances? So when I'm sitting with you and I'm looking, oh, flowery pants, black shirt, these are all appearances. And any thoughts I have of Deborah are also appearances. So they are just marks. The word in Sanskrit is lakshana, and in Chinese the Diamond Sutra uses the word xiang, which is the eye and the tree. When you see, when you're looking through the woods, you have a perception, you have a certain view, you have a certain appearance of things. And as we know, well, at least in my psyche, when I go through the woods, especially if it's a little dark, the perceptions are very interesting. They're not, it's not reality. Okay, so that character of appearance, what are the marks, what are the appearances? Don't dwell in the marks, is kind of an interesting thing. And that same character, by the way, on the book Into Being, I don't have it on me, but you know, xiangzhi, it's the same appearance. The seal of appearances is actually the word for into being. Okay, the seal of appearances, because that word, as it happens, it's a play on word. Xiang can also mean mutuality. So it's, in this case, it means the seal of mutuality. But it can also mean appearance. So mutuality, we have to break through. The Chinese could have chosen many words, They were very smart, these people who translated. That's why I'm interested. I do these little Dharma discussions in my head with these unknown people to me who translated stuff between 500, 800, you know, of this era from Sanskrit to Chinese, because they really tried, they had a whole other culture to be able to relate to the original teachings, as well as many cultures that have passed from the time of the Buddha to the time they translated. So they had a huge capacity of looking at many interpretations and choosing a language in which you say something, but the written may also imply a whole lot more. So they could have chosen many words, but they chose this word because it's through breaking through appearances. It's exactly what the Diamond Sutra says. Yes, you need to look at the appearances in order to break through and understand into being. So the two words have the same exact character in them. You know, so it's kind of like, and it's exactly what the Diamond Sutra says. It isn't like this unless it is exactly not like this. It's only when you can undo your concepts of what it is that you can actually touch what it is. So when we're sitting in front of another person and I'm going, oh, this is you, or then I'm thinking, oh, I actually know you. Yeah, I know your wife too. I don't know. I have a whole story around you, blah, 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 blah. It's like, am I sure? Is this really the person? You know, this is the appearance of the person, and the appearance can have many layers too. And we convince ourselves that we know. So the tool of interbeing, the tool of everything changes, the tool of I'm related to my, I am part of my ancestors, these are just tools so we can start looking deeper. They may still be appearances, we don't know. Until we are Buddhas, we don't know what the absolute 100% conviction of the depth of everything is. I can't tell you, I don't know. But I do know that I need to shed all my judgments, my perceptions, my ideas. And that's what the Buddha is asking us to do. And that's very much related to our suffering. Because we suffer because of our ideas, we suffer because of our perceptions. We suffer because I think there's something wrong here. You know, it's very hard for us to come and say, it appears like it's wrong, and it's true, I don't like it. I mean, look, you don't like tomato soup, you don't like tomato soup. I mean, you know, it's like no matter how much I can convince you, it just looks like tomato soup, but it really should taste like macaroni. It's not, you know, to your taste buds, it's not going to taste like something else that you might like. Still tastes like tomato soup. But I can open up to, so I happen not to like tomatoes, or I don't like cucumbers, or I don't like this person. No big deal. Can I embrace it regardless? It's just one more appearance, one more touching of one sense. In this case, it's my taste buds. In another, it might be what I'm hearing. In another, it's what I'm seeing. It's just, or it's what's producing thoughts in me. But it's just one aspect. It's one thing. And there's so much more. What we narrow onto these things, onto these perceptions, we hold them as if that's all there is, and that is the truth with capital T. And that's what the Diamond Sutra is asking us to do, to be able to undo that. So the sutra starts like many sutras, but a little bit more so, strangely enough, even though we do not believe this is an original sutra from the Buddha's time. There'll be people who claim that it is, and that's, I don't know, I'm not that kind of scholar to be able to tell, or to even have an opinion. But the Buddha starts with, the Buddha is coming back from lunch, basically, you know, the alms round. He has his lunch, I can't remember, you know, he washes his feet, he undoes his robes and sits down, and maybe he has a siesta in the middle, doesn't, you know, whatever it is that the Buddha does. And then he says to people, got, you know, anybody has a question, you know, come and ask. It's basically the beginning of the sutra. And that's actually, in some ways, and many people say, this is it, this is the sutra. Because the sutra is, then Sabuddhi is, apparently he was an older monk. He may well have been the brother of those of you who know the teachings given to the sick or have heard of the Anattapindika, you know, in monastery in the Jetta Grove. He's the guy that bought the Jetta Grove and started paving it with gold so that he could buy it. Sabuddhi is rumored to have been Anattapindika's brother. which is a little bit interesting. Here are the two Prajnaparamita sutras that most of us have heard of, at least. They're famous. The Heart Sutra, which is given by Avalokiteshvara, and he's talking to Shariputra. And if you know, there is a sutra called Teachings to be Given to the Sick, which Shariputra gives the exact same teaching to Anathapindika when Anathapindika is dying. And here's this other sutra where Sabuddhi is the one asking the question here, and it's a dialogue between the Buddha and Sabuddhi. The Buddha is explaining to Sabuddhi what's going on. So these two apparently, whether by myth or in reality, were related. So it might tell us something, historically, about the people who wrote the sutras and what they thought and what they, which characters they wanted to bring in and stuff. So Sabuddhi says to the Buddha, I have a question for you. And the question is, I know you are encouraging the bodhisattvas. The bodhisattva way is the thing you're encouraging the most. What advice would you give us? He says, sons and daughters of good family, it doesn't matter. What advice would you give us to become bodhisattvas? How would you walk? How would you stand? Interesting. And how would you master the mind? Okay. That's the question. That's what the Buddha is answering in this sutra. Notice the Buddha's already stood, the Buddha's already sat, he already washed his feet, he already ate, he's already done everything a Buddha does. There is no Buddha except that person that is sitting in front of Sabuddhi. So there was already an answer. There's an answer. The Buddha doesn't do anything special. The Buddha has his lunch, the Buddha sits, the Buddha breathes. The Buddha just, the difference, the Buddha does it mindfully, the Buddha does it with full awareness, and the Buddha has a certain kind of mind that supports it. But right off the bat, we're seeing that the practice that we have in Plum Village of eating, walking, sitting, that practice, just the basic of just do, I have arrived, I am home. This is what a Buddha does. The Buddha doesn't do anything terribly different, at least not externally. And internally, the Buddha doesn't do anything different because he just simply arrives. He might arrive more successfully than some of us. Well, some of us, I can't speak for other people. So it's all about, have I arrived? And there's another word that's used very commonly in the sutra is do not dwell. I think in English, the English is a little bit different, do not rely on, depending on how it's translation. But Buju, Ju is to reside. It's literally your residence card would be a Ju card, not Z-H-U. I guess it would be a Ju card also. But it's like it's a flame. It's the stillness of the flame. Don't stay there. Don't stay in the appearances. Don't stay in form. Don't stay in sound. Don't reside in smell, taste, touch, objects of mind. Don't stay there. Know that that's what you're seeing, and keep moving away. Keep moving, opening up to more possibilities. Don't be caught in it. Don't dwell. In order for me, now, I've arrived, I'm home, excuse me, sounds exactly like I dwell, right? This is exactly what the sutra is about. In order to arrive, I need to not dwell, because if I dwell on, oh, this is so beautiful, blah, 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 these flowers are so beautiful, and I'm stuck there, I haven't arrived. These flowers are really beautiful, and you know what? At some point now, yeah, I know that these are orchids. Is that behind the leaf? And I know that orchids last a very long time, but at one point, trust me, it's gonna like wilt and deteriorate, and the stuff that happens to everything. So if I reside in, it's like the people who we build our, and this is a very common theme nowadays. Everybody's got a book on how to set up your beautiful meditation room that is just gorgeous and has, and there's stores that will You know, you can buy everything that you need for, you know, from the incense to the beads to the blah, blah, to, you know, there's a whole feng shui that goes around it. But if we rely on that to be able to sit, I mean, gee, it's like, it's got a little bit of a problem, you know. It's very nice to have a nice meditation room, and it's very nice to be here, by the way. Thank you, David. I mean, it's really, it's incredible. But we don't want to be rely on it. We don't want to have to dwell here, because we want to dwell in the non-dwelling of our own minds. And the moment I'm caught with, I must sit on my cushion, you know, and I bring my cushion to every retreat and only sit on that cushion. It's like, okay, yes, I get it. You know, some people's knees are not so good, you know, but there's, you know, I don't want to get too attached to it. I want to be able to try something else all the time, always open myself up. So non-dwelling in order to dwell, in order to arrive. So the Diamond Sutra really is the basis of the Plum Village practice. Not because it is the Zen Sutra. You know, it's like, yeah, anybody can say, but because it's so clearly related to, I've arrived, I am home, in the here and in the now. I am solid, I am free. In the ultimate I dwell. Okay, that's, you know, it's like, so here we are, the ultimate and the practical meet. You know, this is what Thay says all the time. You see the ultimate by the way you walk. You see the ultimate by the way you sit. You see the ultimate by stopping and calming. There is no vipassana, there's no insight, there's no deep looking without shamatha, without stopping, calming. We've got to stop and calm. And then insight slowly, slowly penetrates, sometimes faster, sometimes slower. With some subjects, insight may arrive 20, 30 years later. The only prerequisites, the only thing we can do is to stop and calm. The only thing we can do is to, in order to stop and calm, is to provide the practice environment for our lives so we can stop and calm. And that's hard. For us, it's really easy when you're in a place like Blue Cliff or Plum Village or Deer Park. You know, it's like it's all set up for us. You know, we as lay people, it's not so easy. We don't have lovely bells throughout the day. We may get a clock, and if you're like me, you sort of start reaching a contact with yourself. It's like, I can't stop for the clock when I'm on the phone all the time. It's like, you know, I can't do it. You know, so you kind of let it go, and you begin to say, there's another kind of stopping. Yes, there's a clock when I'm still doing what I'm doing, but I developed a different attitude. So I'm doing, I did bring myself some space. But when in the monastery, we don't do that. We really stop. We have morning sitting. We have breakfast that takes a long time. We have, you know, there's a Dharma talk. That's what a retreat is. And it's fabulous. It gives us the opportunity. And we have this challenge of how do we stop? And that's why we came today. So we can deepen our capacity for tolerating the life that we're in, what doesn't want us to stop. You know, even on our days off, when we have nothing to do, we don't stop. To build up our capacity for stopping, calming. Now, some of you may think, oh, I came here to listen to, you know, to understand the, you know, the Diamond Sutra, because next Tuesday there's a test on the Diamond Sutra and I want to have another view. Hope not. Don't think anybody's here for that, but you know, but it's not. You know, we don't understand the Diamond Sutra or any sutra unless we just practice. So all there is just to sit and open up and soften, and let, and the teachings will happen. It will somehow happen. The more we hear the teachings, the more chances we get, you know, for it to manifest in us. But the more we hear without the practice, nothing will happen. You know, it's, I mean, at least, well, maybe for some, I can't say, but, you know, and it's an interesting game to play, listening to teachings and analyzing the teachings and reading. So, I mean, this is something I happen to like. Okay, I happen to like reading sutras, and I happen to like researching, you know, and looking at the linguistics of it, and what do I think of it. And so, really, it's like having Dharma discussions with some people from some other century, you know. But that's not my practice. If that's my practice, that's pretty bad. I mean, that's really kind of miserable, you know, because, you know, as well, I couldn't do a PhD at Harvard on it, but, you know, it's kind of like, you know, I might as well go and do a PhD somewhere on whatever, Buddhism or intellectual religious studies, whatever, you know, which is nothing wrong with it. It just is not what the Buddha is encouraging us to do. So right from the very beginning of the sutra, the answer is right there. The Buddha simply sits, the Buddha simply breathes, the Buddha simply eats lunch, and he does it with full concentration and full awareness. So there is a question, like, what can I do to master my mind? So the Buddha could have said, Subuddhi, didn't you just see? Like, what are you asking for? I mean, you know, you're dumb. What's your problem? You know, it's like, okay, so your brother is a really rich person, and he gave us this monastery, but, you know what's going on. No, but the Buddha gets why the question is there. He knows. And he also gets that the question is not in some ways, that's my interpretation. The Buddha gets that the question is asking for something that can't be asked. The Buddha doesn't quite know how to ask the question. So the Buddha from how do you master your mind, he turns it around. It's not master, it's not constrict your mind. I mean, Subuddhi is basically sort of asking him for tricks. Give me the, we all know this thing. It's like I'm sitting and I'm like having all these thoughts. I'm like, okay, I'm supposed to be meditating. Like, what's wrong with me? Dear Buddha, give me your best trick for sitting well and, being spacious. That's basically the question. That's what it sounds like to me. And the Buddha gets it. And the Buddha also, in some ways, gets that it's not, of course the Buddha gets it. Well, I think the Buddha gets it. I don't know. It's my projection on the Buddha. That it's not about restricting the mind. It's not about that. It's about opening the mind. So the Buddha says, the answer is compassion. The way you master your mind is you have this thought. Here's the thought that you should have. It's not about eliminating thoughts. Here is the thought you should have. I want to liberate all beings, and I want to bring them to the shore of liberation. So the answer is, how do you master your mind? First part of the answer is, open yourself up to all beings, whether they're born from the womb, from the egg, from moisture. Do they have perceptions? They don't have perceptions. These are various technical terms that, in the Indian world of the time, there were different ideas of how beings come to be. To all beings, open yourself up to all beings and have the great desire to liberate them. We may ask, what does it mean to liberate? And that's what the answer is going to be also. And then the Buddha sort of like, that's the kind of like, whoops, okay, that sounded kind of cool and nice, and we think we can do that, and we all know that we can't quite do that so easily, but that's the part that's, we think we get that. And then the Buddha says, but as you bring all these multitudes of beings to the other shore, you know, this is the prerequisites of this, you know that not a single being has been liberated. Why is that? He says to Subuddhi, this phrase, why is that, is in the sutra all the time. There's this challenge, challenging us. Why is it? Why is it? Because if we think that there is someone to be liberated, then we're not really a bodhisattva, then we're caught in the notion of self, human, a being, and lifespan. So he says, a bodhisattva, as we do the best we can to liberate them. But the way to liberate them is really to explain, to bring them to this idea of non-self, non-person, non-beings, non-lifespan. That's really the true liberation. It's not giving them bread. Not that that's not important. But the real liberation is to be able to, for us to all understand that there is no self. And if there is no, I have to understand that there is no self. And if there's no self, then who am I liberating? I'm just liberating myself. All beings are liberating myself. I am I am not liberating any particular person. There is no person. There's only appears to be people to be liberated. But in truth, there. you know, that's just an appearance. Behind it, that person I'm liberating is really myself. That person has ancestors that ultimately I'm going to come back are my ancestors. Not just genetically, but just because we all want the same things. We're all ultimately psychically the same. We're trying to avoid suffering and we're trying to be happy. However, our definitions of happiness are slightly different, you know, and maybe even wrong, because happiness is also just an appearance, just like suffering is just an appearance. So I want to have this great desire to liberate all beings. Number one, because compassion opens me up to all these beings. But number two, because I want to liberate all these beings, because I see that there are no beings in the conventional sense. They are me and I am them. We're not different. So of course I want to liberate them. And how can I liberate them? Well, if I am them and if I am you and you are me, if I liberate me, I liberate you. You know, there's no other way around it. Now, whether you know it and act that way afterwards in the conventional world is a different story. You know, it's not a prison, we can't force it. But that's kind of what the Buddha is saying. So the Buddha is saying, don't constrict, open. And then watch your notions around it. And then everything will fall into place. If you have great compassion and you have wisdom, of the wisdom of non-self, it will happen. It will just happen. You will become a Buddha. So, there's a bunch of sections about what is the Buddha, what is the Buddha body, and there's 32 marks of the Buddha, that people may have heard of. You know, there's supposed to be 32 marks, and it's actually the one place where the Buddha is kind of interesting. He actually gives us an example of why the Buddha is trying to make us see whatever we're seeing and naming it conventionally. When I'm saying this is a cup, you know, that's a conventional designation. We all agree it's a cup. Is it a cup? You know, I mean, because I'm not a Buddha, I didn't go through the three watches of the night. I'm not exactly sure. I think it's some clay or something, but it has earthy substance in it. You know, there was heat that came into creating it. It has tons of things in it. Right now it's a cup. It holds the shape of a cup and it holds my hot water. But it could be anything. Maybe not at this moment, it still appears like a cup, but you know, in 100 years, I'm not so sure. And I'm not so sure what, you know, this could appear like a lake to a fly. You know, so I'm calling it a cup of my water, and some teeny little creature may say, oh, big lake, yellow lake, I love it. You know, so we don't know because the perceptions are so different. So this is the appearance. This appearance serves me. It's very convenient. I can drink from this cup. But it's still an appearance. Behind the cup, there's so much more. How much more behind people? You know, if I can do this exercise of looking, where did this cup come from? How many lives are intertwined in this cup? You know, how many materials, God knows where they really came from, again, because we're not Buddhas, so we just have this understanding that there's many causes and conditions that came into the cup, but we don't expect ourselves to be able to see every single one to the infinite depth through all of space and time. If I can do that with a cup, how much more so on a human being? We're so much more complex, we think, than a cup. So there's just this tremendous step. So when I'm looking at another person and I'm trying to see who are your ancestors, they may not be just your mother and father and their parents. Who are your ancestors? Who are my ancestors? So that I can see, we are one. And this is what meditation is. In Sanskrit, the word dhyana is, if you look in the culture of the Buddha came from, that's why I gave you some of the Yoga Sutras, so that you can do some little bit of comparisons, so you see what that culture was. Dhyana, or jhana, is defined as subject and object become one. It's actually, that part is not on the handout, I'm sorry.
But when you're looking, you know, those of you who do yoga and have ever studied the eight limbs of yoga by Patanjali, jnana is the seventh limb, and it's defined as subject and object become one. You've all heard this phrase, whether you heard it in yoga or you heard it from Thai. There is no differentiation between subject and object. When the Chinese heard jnana or jhana, they made it into chan. Chan became Zen in Japan, and therefore we have Zen. Okay, so we have this lovely phrase, Zen, and that phrase, of course, is we want nice little Zen meditation rooms, sort of thing. So Zen, Chan, the character is one ancestor. Again, very smart how they chose these characters. I know it's not meaningful for most of us because we don't read Chinese, but it just happens to be my process, so that's why I'm talking about it. Meditation is, if we all have one ancestor, there's no differentiation between you and me. Subject and object have become one. It was a different way of saying it than the Indians said it. Because in Sanskrit, there isn't this capacity of writing, making pictures in the character and having a whole other meaning. So they say, jnana, its meaning is subject and object are one, no differentiation. There's no more subject, no more object. In the Chinese, they could do it through some, you know, through the pictographic understanding of the character. So it's very nice. So we know that meditation is to become one. This is what meditation is. So when we, in order to do that, the Buddha is saying, bring about compassion and bring about wisdom, prajna. And where are they going to come from? They're going to come from my mindfulness, from my stopping and calming, because there's no other place for them to come from. They can only come from there. So stopping, calming, shamatha. So we all know there is this, you know, if both at Blue Cliff and at Deer Park, in all the monasteries, you see, it's not Shila, they use samadhi, samadhi prajna, smirti. Samadhi prajna, thank you very much. And instead of smirti, you know, usually the phrase is, instead of smirti is mindfulness or recollecting, often it's used as shila, prajna samadhi. Shila means mindfulness. So they can, you know, but shila is usually used in terms of the mindfulness trainings. So we can have a whole other sort of triangle, you know, like triangulation of three concepts, which is the mindfulness, our stopping, calming, to be mindful, to be aware, our compassion, it supports our compassion, and our compassion supports our stopping, calming, and our insight, they support each other, our wisdom. All three, it's like a cycle. It doesn't matter which one you enter through. You know, they will support each other, and you want to develop all three. So, so really looking at these ideas of what is the self, what is a person, in other words, the human race. You know, we think we're different than everybody else. What are all beings? You know, the multitudes of beings out there. And what is my lifespan? You know, this idea that I was born. So in other words, now, these are just some, these are four notions. There are actually in some other Prajnaparamita Sutras, there's a lot more notions. So this is a little bit like, you know, everybody loves the 51 mental formations. We, you know, many years ago, Thay said, you know, there are 51 mental formations and mindfulness is one of them and, you know, sadness is one of them. And this one, you know, he listed a few. And of course we all went, you know, this actually happened before my time, but for years people would, we want to know what these mental formations are. We want to grab them. And then suddenly around maybe 2000, 2001, he actually gave us the list, you know. It was before the Wikipedia. We didn't have the ability to just go and grab 51 mental formations. And any of you who are at the Blue Cliff Retreat, you got a list of 51 mental formations. He talked about two of them and kind of left them behind. And it's really interesting how we all love having this piece of paper. 51 mental formations. Can I memorize? Blah, blah, you know. It's like, it's just a list. There could be 78. There could have been 8,000. It's just saying there are many seeds in our consciousness. There are many mental formations in us. And someone went and listed a bunch of them, you know, as these are kind of pretty useful. And I'm not sure where we came to the 51 mental formations. Someone remembers how I got into it? never mind. That there's four notions, and there's many notions that we entertain. You know, these are just four notions, and these are strong notions that we have. Why have this? Well, obviously, this idea of lifespan is extremely important because we have so much fear about death and what will I accomplish in this life. So, you know, our mortality, and it's interesting, this living being versus lifespan. It's kind of an interesting, that the multitudes of beings have a lifespan according to conventional thinking. That's how we classify them as living beings. They have a lifespan. They come, they go. Yeah. So we have these ideas that I have a self, that I am this thing, that I am a human being, that I am mortal, I have a lifespan. And then I distinguish between myself and the other people, the humans, myself between the other multitudes of people, of beings, all beings, you know, even though we all have a lifespan. And then I distinguish between my lifespan and what? But it's mine. And that's the challenge, to look, who is this person, you know, like that I think is me, you know, like, because I know, I mean, there's no doubt that when I was 2 years old, I did not look like this. In fact, I guarantee you I did not look like this yesterday, because I shaved yesterday evening, for one thing, and I wasn't wearing these clothes yesterday. I do recall that. I am a different person. I mean, we know that I've eaten breakfast since then. I mean, there's different thoughts within me. I keep changing. Am I the same person that I was when I was 2 or 5 or 20 or 40? I am not the same person, and yet I am the same person. Yeah. And this has huge implications when we're looking at people. You know, is this person, and some of you will relate very strongly to that, is this person that's standing in front of me and possibly, you know, slobbering all over the place, barely able to eat, you know, like doesn't remember who I am, is this my parent or not? Appearances are very deceiving, you know. They are and they are not, because they're not the same parent that I have the appearance that I latch onto. I may have latched onto an appearance over 40, 50, 60 years of an appearance, and there are many appearances, and yet this one is still different. There are all sorts of appearances to things, so we can latch onto that. You know, who is this person? I think I know who you are, and I actually probably don't. And to remind ourselves of that with every person, not just the ones that we love, where it's very painful and it opens us, hopefully opens us up, but to open us up to every person that we meet and everything that we meet. That, to me, is the practice. So we can arrive at that many ways. We can intellectualize it. We all understand I am not the person I was. We all understand, you know, I was born November 11, 1958, and I know that beforehand I was in my mother's womb, and before, 9 months before that, I was genetically in, you know, in the genetic code, and therefore I was in the genetic code of throughout all generations. When we look at birth, we're all very willing. Okay. Take me there, I'm buying into it. There's no birth. I think we're all willing to buy in some manner or another. It's the no death that we get stuck on. It's like, you know, I gave you the no birth bit. It's like, I'm done. You know, that was kind of not, I got it, but it still isn't fully logical for me. And it's that no death part where we go, Well, if my genetic code was there before I was born, my genetic code is there after I'm done, you know, when I die. If my thoughts were there in my consciousness, the kind of thinking that I have, my culture is shifting and changing, but human culture, human desires, human thoughts have been there. So I've been there. It's like I am part of all of that. I was there, and I will continue to be there, whether I have blood descendants, or spiritual descendants, or no descendants at all in my own thinking, or whatever it is that I think. There will be others with this consciousness, whether there are humans or non-humans. There will, I continue. I don't continue like this. But I didn't continue like this from yesterday to today. I keep changing, I keep shifting. And that notion that death is just one more transition and we're not gone, because we want, okay, so if you're not gone, where are you? Oh, okay, now you've reincarnated into the rat or into the high lama, or, it's like we're grasping so much. Buddha's telling us, drop it. It's not. And that's one of the reasons, I think, why the Buddha was supposedly very much not willing to talk about what happens after death, because it's too difficult for us to accept that either there is or there isn't, because we don't know, and it doesn't matter. But what matters is that I can live my life here and now, and with this understanding, there'll be some transformation, some transition, just like between today and tomorrow, there'll be some transition. I promise to wear different clothes, so it's obvious tomorrow. So, but it's always different. But no, we want to control, we need to grab it. So the Buddha's saying, stop it, just stop. Relax your ideas. Let go of all these ideas. And then he gives us a really wonder. I mean, it's just such an amazing example. So I said he gave one example, and actually he does give a few examples. One example on don't get caught by appearances, because they're very deceiving. He gives the example, when you look at me, I'm the Buddha. I'm supposed to have the 32 marks of an enlightened being. And the problem is here, so these 32 marks are called the chakravarti, the turning of the wheel marks. And the problem is there's two kinds of turners, wheel turners. There is Buddhas who are turning the wheel of the Dharma, and then there's the supreme ruler politically who will unify India or northern India, and who turns the wheel, the political wheel, by unifying India. So the Buddha is saying to Subhuti, if you see me, if you think you can tell who I am by the 32 marks, some of them are things like, the Buddha has very long ears because he can hear throughout worlds. He has a tongue that can, jump over to other worlds. You see this in the Lotus Sutra, he has a very long tongue. I don't know all 32 of them, or some of them I'm not really that, they're not, doesn't matter. but there's also, and there's arguments about, does he have a Dharma wheel on his foot? Does he have a fish or swastikas on the toes? And what difference does it make? You go to a tattoo parlor and you can get whatever you want on your feet. It's like, that does not make a Buddha, very clearly, So the Buddha is saying is that those 32 marks are supposed to be for the other chakravartin as well. They too have it. The political ones have it. How would you know? So he gives us an example of don't be caught by the appearances. Don't be caught by what this person says or does or any, whatever they're doing. Underneath, they are still you. Doesn't matter. And underneath, at the base of it, we're made of the same exact elements, and we're both dependent on the sun, and we're both dependent on this planet, and we're both dependent on rain being out there, and all that kind of stuff. We're not different. There's an appearance. You are like this, and I don't like this, and I do like this, and and we have resonances, and that's fine. But they're just, they're temporary, even if that temporary lasts 20, 30, 40, 50 years. And then the other example, that tells us why is this so important in terms of our suffering. So this is advice to bodhisattvas, and the bodhisattvas are, you know, the Buddha tells us the bodhisattva use six practices, the six paramitas, to become bodhisattvas, to cross over to the shore, the paramitas, para. Okay. So these six paramitas, they're dana paramita, giving, sila paramita, keeping the precepts, the mindfulness trainings, shanti paramita, endurance, this is the one I want to talk about in a second, virya, strength, or you know, like to the being like a hero, you know vira vidrasana in yoga, that's that vira, the strength of it, and jnana, meditation, and prajna, wisdom. These are the six paramitas. We use those six things, but they're related to each other. So often you will see in texts they talk about generosity, dana paramita. When they say dana paramita, they mean all six. It's a cycle. And because with dana, to give, to be generous, means to give in the sutra, here again, the same thing comes up. To give means to have the wisdom of non-giver, non-gift, no one receiving, to see that they're all the same. When I give, I don't give and be caught in the signs, ooh, I was a very generous person, you know, I am such a good person, I deserve to have a monastery named after me. And we all do this, you know, in like little weird ways, and, you know, to give is to just, can I give just to give? And beyond that, which is fabulous, I mean, that's quite an accomplishment, I think, for most of us, at least for me it is. And then to go beyond and see, wow, there really is no difference between me and the person I'm giving to. And that the person that I'm supposedly giving to is actually giving me. Even if nothing else but the opportunity to give, the opportunity to open my heart. And to see that what is being given is inherently in both of us already anyway. Because the greatest gift, the real gift, is the gift of non-fear, the gift of seeing there is no self, there is no human. That's the real gift. There is no lifespan. That's already in each one of us. There is nothing to attain. We just have to shed the layers that are over it, shed the appearance, penetrate through the appearance, then we see. So, the Buddha gives us this other example about the shanti paramita. In Chinese, it's zhen. It's the knife in the heart. When I have a knife in my heart, can I endure it? Can I, you know, we all have knives in our hearts all the time. You know, they may not look like knives. They may look like my neighbor or someone else, you know, the person who drove in front of me or whatever it is. Someone, you know, we all have knives in our hearts, and it's the capacity to keep the heart open in spite of the knife and not keep twisting the knife. So the Buddha talks about, when I was this other Buddha in this other time in King Kali, my understanding of the story, I'm not sure if that's totally the correct story, because, you know, when we hear it in the 21st century, we make up a whole bunch of cultural representations about what we think the story is. I think the Buddha was a very, very good bodhisattva, and you know, was attracting all these people. So all these women in the harem of King Kali went to hear the Buddha, and you know, maybe it was like the Pied Piper. You know, it's like they all came, and you know, they wanted to be near this wonderful quality. You know, it's like, you know, Thai attracts all these people. And then King Kali came and he said, oh, hey, you're stealing all my women, and cut his limbs off and pull his eyes out and that kind of stuff. And the Buddha said, I was able to take that without any anger. I was able to practice shanti paramita, zhen. Why? Because I didn't have this idea that I have a self. You cut off the limb, it's not mine. You know, we have many stories. Of course, I haven't seen anyone personally, but we have stories like that. You know, like some of us have went to, maybe not some of us, but we went to these Avalokiteshvara caves in northern Vietnam, and the story is about this princess, and she gives up everything. You know, that's why she becomes this great martyr. You know, that you can cut off her limbs, and she still is able to regenerate, in spite of the suffering, because she's not attached to her form or to anything. So these
people who immolate themselves, they're not attached, hopefully. You know, got me people do it for different reasons. I can't guarantee, you know. But some of them, the ones that we really admire, have this capacity of saying, I can kill myself, and it's not even a violation of the first training of do not kill, because I see that I truly see fully the non-self of me. Therefore, I can burn myself. And traditionally, Buddhist monks would have, they would burn themselves three times at the top of the head. Some do it here. A lot of traditions no longer do that. It is a little, I mean, you know, it's basically it's branding. It's a little bit, whoa. But you will see people still to this day that have that here, three marks. It is to be able to burn myself. In India originally it was about burning one's karma, you know. But it's really about the capacity of burning my, you know, seeing myself as non-self. And from that, so if I can truly see this, maybe I can truly burn myself. Because I see that my lifespan is not this. And, you know, I'm looking at you and I'm seeing like this. Sounds nice, but I don't think so. And I think that's what we all do. All these people in Tibet or in Vietnam that do, it's just, that's the contemplation for us to like, wow, how do they manage? I mean, that's why the Buddha brings this example. During the time of King Kali, when my body was dismembered, this is what, I didn't have this thought, and that's why I did not suffer, but I didn't have anger. This, to me, personally, that's pretty much the pinnacle of practice. You know, to be able to do that, to be able to have that kind of openness, that kind of non-attachment, to not be caught in my life, my nervous system's telling me it's painful. I mean, I'm pretty sure if somebody cut my arm, I'm not so sure. You know, don't know that I'll be so calm. That's like an incredible inspiration. That's what we practice for. We practice for the difficult times. We practice for the suffering. So that when the suffering comes, it's easy. You know, when we're, you know, when everything is cool and wonderful and, you know, lovely breakfast, lovely retreat, da-da-da-da-da, everybody supports me. That's pretty easy. And even within that, suddenly it's like, I feel alone. Nobody in this retreat likes me. It's like I'm the only person that doesn't understand anything. I'm the only person that has this weird thought. It's like, you know, it's like, I've gone to enough retreats to know that I do this every single one and all the time. And have talked to enough people to know that they all do the same thing. So it's a universal phenomenon. You know, the suffering catches up with us. You know, there's this moment we hear the bell and it's like, wow, I've shed all my suffering. And then the habit is so strong and it comes a little differently than usual, granted. Then I open up again. You know, that's why we do these things. So the challenge is to be able to give ourselves the openness of the environment to build up the reservoir, the bank of shamatha, of stopping calming, so that wisdom will just somehow penetrate us. There's no way it will penetrate us intellectually. It just ain't going to happen. It's not going to be meaningful when we need it. So that when we're caught, it will be there. There's a personal story that made me understand this. Many years ago, we had a rift in our community. And I knew many of the people who were very prominent at the time. We had a retreat. And different ones of these, you know, these are people, they were my teachers. These were my Dharma teachers. These were people I looked up to, like, you know, and the Buddha tells us, don't be caught even in the appearance of the Buddha. Don't be caught in the teachings are just a raft. That phrase is in that sutra, by the way. The teachings are just a raft. Don't be caught in Dharmas, don't be caught in non-Dharmas. Here were these people, and they were just like, wow, you know, you're just like, you're the cat's meow. You know, you really got it together, supposedly. And some of you might think that I've got it together. Well, let me tell you, I don't. Before you have any notions, drop the notion. Just because I'm sitting talking doesn't necessarily, I'm
it's just my experience, that's all. It doesn't mean anything. So, and they wanted to, one of them, for example, wanted to see Tai, and Tai wouldn't see her. He said, I gave you everything you need. And she was crying. I mean, really crying. It was awful. This was a person I really love. And I watched, and another person said, oh, you know, after the, you know, I organized this retreat, and at the end nobody thanked me, and, you know, I walk by Tai and he doesn't even look at me. You know, I don't know, I wasn't there, I can't say, I'm not justifying, not justifying, nothing, doesn't matter. And I was like, wow, where is your, and she said to me, what do you think I should do? And I said, well, this is the person who happened to have written this stuff. And I said, I remember that you typed this sentence. You should ask Tai, the person that you have a problem with, ask them to meet you on Friday. Darling, I'm suffering. Please meet me on Friday. Let's begin anew. Let's do the peace treaty. And this person looked at me like, you typed it. Don't look at me like there's something unusual about this. Because I realized when we suffer, all the Dharma, all the practice, right? There's nothing wrong with this person. This person is a wonderful practitioner. I still admire this person. I haven't lost any respect for this person. But it made me realize the practice is not always available for us. And that's why we have to keep working on it. We have to keep stopping. And, you know, I told you about my clock at my house. That's bad practice, ultimately. Because, yes, I do it, but I cheat. We're cheating all the time. So the challenge for us is, yes, we have to cheat. There's no option, because we're living life as it is, you know, and we will cheat, and it's not the end of the world. But to keep motivating ourselves towards the practice, keep coming back. Doesn't matter how many times the phone rings. You know, it took me literally 15 years. It's now 20. 15 years before I actually stop for the phone. I believe it might be a perception, I don't want to be caught in the appearance. I believe that I do stop for every phone, most phone calls, I'll say, for the first three rings and breathe in and out. It took me 15 years to train. I was trying, and I would go, what the hell's the matter with you? It's so simple. You know, and the hand goes and grabs the phone. You know, it's like that. The habit energy is so strong, and we just have to keep coming back to not all the ideas of the Diamond Sutra, because they're hard, and they're easy, and they're also very elusive in the sense that we think we've got them, and then we find ourselves like totally going against them. But to come back to calming and stopping. Come back to the basic practice of walking, sitting, paying attention to who I am, to what's going on within me, so that I understand who I am. I am not this thing that I think I am. Wisdom will arise on its own. We don't need to worry about reading the Diamond Sutra. It's a wonderful thing to do. It's encouraging. It's fabulous. We need to just do the practice. I used to have a yoga teacher, Guruji, with Patabi Joyce. He had this phrase, you just do. Whatever it is that he would adjust you and do weird things. And, you know, sometimes you'd go, Guruji, I can't take my leg behind my head today. I can't do this weird. He'd stand you up at the end of the practice, and he would just like bend you over backwards and have you grab your heels from the back. You know, and you'd just stand there and go, oh my God. No, and it was just like, you just do. That was a phrase of his, you just do. Doesn't matter, maybe you won't reach your heels, trust me, I never reach my heels, but it doesn't matter, you just do it. And he had this sort of idea, you know, you can stand with your legs as far apart as you want, totally turned out. Mr. Iyengar would have had a fit if he's, you know, well, Mr. Iyengar knew he was his teacher, but, you know, it doesn't matter. But it's like, it does, all this stuff that we do must be aligned. Just do it. Just do the practice. We just need to do the practice. We just need to stop and calm. And the rest is like lovely ideas. And I gave you a whole bunch in the handout. You know, I gave you, you know, the Diamond Sutra is a huge source of influence on everything out there. Whether it's on Nagarjuna,
And I gave you, like, you know, this very famous phrase from Nagarjuna, which is basically whatever, well, I'll take it from the Chinese, all that arises from dependent co-arising, meaning everything that's formed, I call them emptiness. I also call them metaphor, meaning conventional designation. They're nothing but a conventional designation. That is the middle way, meaning I can see the conventional designation of a cup, and I can also willing to go beyond it. I'm not stuck right there and then, just in my notions of what the cup is. I understand these are all notions, and we all speak in the notions. We all speak about self. We all speak about I. Of course there's an I. But I don't want to be caught in it. That's when we can use the words, and it's okay. And I gave you some things about, you know, there's a lot in the sutra about merit. So I gave you some stuff from the Yoga Sutras about, you know, punya. It's a big concept in Asian culture is merit. What is this merit that we're all trying to accumulate? So interesting for us as Westerners, this body of merit. But, you know, it's like, and another wonderful concept that the Buddha gives in the Diamond Sutra is, so, okay, so I'm willing to say, okay, so I'll let go of all the intellectual concepts and the idea of enlightenment and just do it. Just do my practice. Just do the calming and the stopping so that wisdom will arise. And the Buddha is giving us this fabulous metaphor about, you know, these kilocosms and what will happen in different generations. You know, the Buddha asks in 500 or the last epoch of whatever, and will people understand? The Buddha says, yes, they will understand. And those that I understand, I will see them. There's this incredible connection to see the Buddha and the Buddha sees you, to have that trust, meaning that faith also comes into it. Faith is an incredibly important energy. To have faith in the practice, to have faith in the Buddha, whatever the Buddha means to us. The Buddha might be your cat. It's okay. So to have faith, and also the Buddha talks about all these, throughout, he says, these people, that they may not know me, and they have faith in this practice, it's because they've practiced throughout all generations, throughout so many other Buddhas, so many multitudes of Buddhas. So to have the faith that maybe, you know, it's like some people say, you know, maybe not this lifetime, maybe next lifetime. But it's not so much about the lifetime, it's just that I just contribute to the immeasurable ocean of merit through my practice, to the best ability. Someone out there, in whatever era of space and time, will and is reaching the shore of liberation. And my wave is helping. That's, I think, how to think of liberation. Not I must reach the, you know, because the truth is, let's be really honest about it, there are very few people that many, many people practice, many, 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 many more people than that don't practice. And out of the many people that practice, a few, like you go, wow, I mean, there's one Thich Nhat Hanh in this world. I mean, it's like 7 billion people. And one amazing, I mean, there's of course others, but I personally have had the opportunity to meet and the fortune to be influenced by. It's like not terribly good odds for being enlightened in a sense. You know, it's like, not that I know that I would like the idea that I'm saying he's enlightened, I'm not, which I did not say, by the way. But we don't know, but does that stop me from practicing? I mean, I'm pretty sure, I mean, no, I'm not sure, but I'm pretty sure that I'm probably not likely to be like this incredible capacity of seeing everything, you know, and knowing all the causes and conditions and being fully compassionate and open at all times, you know. The moment I do just touch that, it's good enough. It's perfect. And just keep at it. And someone out there who's no different than me. And in some cases, he was called the Buddha from the Shakya clan, the Shakyamuni Buddha, has reached it. Someone else will. Lots of others have. They're not different than me. Them reaching it is me reaching it. Even though this appearance of Avi sure does not look too close. But just the fact that someone like Nagarjuna,
that someone like the Buddha, like someone like Wei Ning, the patriarchs, the Zen patriarchs, someone like Tai can reach whatever they reach and have that capacity of openness. It means I have it also, and it means that I'm touching it through them. And all I have to do is keep touching, keep touching, keep touching. So, yeah, I think that's enough for today. And we can maybe do walking meditation outside and really penetrate the appearances of David's garden. So, thank you. Thank you. So let's take a few minutes break and we'll meet. Should we use that entrance, David? Okay. So we'll meet maybe outside. You can pick your shoes up and we'll meet outside in like 5 or 10 minutes so people get time to go to the bathroom and whatever we need to do. We can have a little walk. No, the garden's fairly large. We'll see what ends up. We'll let David lead. And